Good morning.
Good morning and welcome to the 10th International Type 3 Conference.
Robert, something's wrong here.
Yeah, most def.
We're talking about a decade of Type 3 conference. Shouldn't they be more enthusiastic?
Yeah, more ecstatic.
Yeah, definitely.
Maybe it was late yesterday night, too much booze. Yeah. Early tomorrow? No, it's not early.
Didn't get enough sleep.
So, we should give him another try, right?
Yeah, let's try it. Good morning.
Good morning and welcome to the 10th International Type 3 Conference. Yeah, not bad. But you know,
I heard at the Joomla conference, they were really freaking out. They were giving standing ovations.
Naked. So, let's give it another try. Yeah. So give your best, okay?
The last one, we promise.
Okay. Welcome to the 10th International Type 3 Conference! Here we go! Very well.
Thank you very much.
I'm Robert.
And I'm Javier.
And we will be your hosts for the next
3 days. Hope.
Wow. 10 years, huh? Mm-hmm.
You remember the old days?
Oh, yeah. When it all started?
Yeah, it was even more than 10 years ago. Yeah.
Mm. You know, wasn't it this guy from Denmark?
Somewhere in Northern Europe.
Yeah.
He started it all.
Yeah.
What's his name again?
I can't remember, but isn't that guy without whom none of this would have been possible? I mean, you wouldn't have a job.
Yeah.
None of you would have a job. Especially not you. Or you. So, anyway, what's his name?
Something like Jasper?
Vesper. Sylvester?
Sylvester.
No. Oh, yeah. It's Kasper.
Yeah, you're right.
So we're very happy to have him here for this great anniversary T3CON. So please shout from the depth of your lungs, hello to Kasper
Skårhøj.
Woo! The daddy.
Thanks for the applause, guys. I'm curious how many people were on the first conference. Could you raise your hand? Oh, okay. It's not too many. Good to see you here. By the way, I would really like to extend a thanks to Jürgen for organizing the previous 9 conferences. It's been great that you did it, and it meant so much to Type 3 so far. So, yeah. Okay. Who knows who I am just before I was introduced? Okay, so there are still some people who doesn't know much about Type 3. I'm happy to learn that because we are going to look a little bit at the history of Type 3. And I think I've been talking about that so many times that I am maybe sometimes a bit sick and tired of it because I feel like I'm saying it to the same people again and again, but there are some fresh people here, luckily. So today I would also like to take a look back because essentially I cannot tell you much about web development as of today. I can tell you how we did 10 years ago, but I don't do it anymore myself. In fact, in a sense, Type 3 became exactly what I set out to do originally. Back in 1997, I wanted to have a tool to create websites efficiently. And I began to do that. And before I knew, we had a product that I rather liked to share with people, and develop further so other people like you could develop websites. But originally, I just needed a tool myself. And that's what I got today. So yes, I am actually developing on Type3. I have my own extension for the company that we run. We have a website and some specific needs. And I can do it today with the tool I set out to create. And that's actually pretty cool. And I'm very happy that when I stopped 7 years ago developing Type3 actively, somebody else took over. And that's all the great people on the core team and those who work on Flow and NIOS today. Okay, so does it work? Yes, it does work. I think that at least for some of you, it would be interesting to know, what am I doing today then? Because it is kind of changing. So I stopped 7 years ago, and I went to university to get a degree in civil engineering, in fact. And in the meantime, I also started a company, SKAARHOJ, it's called, after myself. And these are my two partners in that company. We have a tiny office of 36 cubic meters. Yeah, we like to emphasize that we spend everything in the room. We have shelves from floor to the ceiling. And we do electronics, customized electronics, and we use our web portal to allow customers to do this. Then I also, what you just saw before, is I'm passionate about video, and I've been working as an e-learning consultant at the Technical University of Denmark for... Why is it so slow? Okay, I'm sorry about that. Maybe if the remote control is the problem, I'll just put it down. Down. Yeah, but this is a Mac, it's usually not slow, so... Okay, so video production, yeah. And recently, I have been working as a technical a CTO for these two guys who are developing film scanners. This is the device that can scan old 16mm films. And what I do here is electronics and electronics. That's a lot of fun, yeah. So I also like to dabble with printed circuit boards once in a while. And okay, I really need to time this, so I have 5 minutes in advance every time I change the slide. And then finally, we have also a family. So I have like my two daughters and some of you. Oh, I'm sorry. I just pushed the back button. So now we are gonna. I'm never gonna do that again. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Really, really. Bill's remaining 8, 7. Oh no, I have to be careful. Somebody told me I could extend my time a little bit because Olivier... And he did that back in Splügen too. I knew it already back then. That's what I remember about you, Olivier. That's the guy who was talking so much. We sat on the slopes talking about Olivier, yeah. Okay, so I have my lovely daughter. She's 8 years old. She's called Emily. Some of you know her because you have met her already. I had another daughter, Nomi, and now I also have a little son. And it's so interesting how boys are interested in technology. That's a boost. That's really, you know, saving the day when I'm imagining this little programmer coming up. I'm really concerned. He likes to play the guitar a lot, and he needs to become an engineer. So I have some challenges there. This is my wife. Okay, so, guys, we are here, okay? We need to ask ourselves why we are here. And I would like to take you back a little bit on this... historical trip. Okay, it's also interesting it's cut in the sides, but that's kind of my graphical style today as well. So it's not. And this is always a great occasion to show a cool picture of me. I thought when I realized I was kind of becoming a computer guru back in around year 2000, I thought, okay, I better grow a beard. Because I Googled some kind of GNU GPL, and then you look in image search in Google and you see some guys, you know, which probably live in the countryside in the United States, and they really look like me there. So it all started back when I dropped out of university. You already see the parallel to Steve Jobs, right? You know? And we decided to go nuts about the internet, which was emerging. And what does Ken have to do with that? That was just a crazy idea that these two guys with whom I started Type3, I just went on this trip to the film festival, and we had lots of ideas, and the time was full of creativity. And this is how great it was. Kind of the first version of Type3, still figuring out how to create something like pages and organizing those. So this is Type3 pre-official. Some of you might have seen it before. but that's how far we were back then. Then we created a company because somebody saw it and they thought, hey man, this can be worth lots of money, and we tried to go this direction. We went to United States, to Silicon Valley. We met with computer people over there, and I had some gurus myself, like David Siegel. Maybe some of you know this guy. He was very famous around the millennium. We don't hear much from him today, I guess, but he had some groundbreaking ideas about what web design should be like, and so did Netscape. And we presented T3CON14 on conferences back then. But then some things happened. We had this company with employees, and we tried to boost development in this way. And I think as a consequence of who I am and the way I prefer to work, it was really difficult for me to continue the development in this context. So essentially, I needed to stop that. And also became more interested in the opposite sex because I didn't have a girlfriend and all these things, and I thought, could it be related to working 16 hours a day? Maybe. I also connected with my roots of Christianity again. So all these things gave me some kind of new perspective of what I actually wanted to do. So the thing was, I had a cool piece of software, but I didn't want to sell it, and I still wanted to finish it because that was what was coming out of me. I just can't leave things half finished, so I needed to finish it. I decided to sit in my dorm room, and then for another year I was working on T3CON14 to finish it. Do you feel the naivety of that idea? But I mean, I remember, Robert.
Is the web server below your desk?
Yes, it is. The first T3CON14.org was served from my 500 kilobit ADSL line in this room. That was really cool. And then at some point, Jürgen luckily took over. We went to a PHP conference once. I think that was starting out our relationship. And in some talk or on a piece of paper, there was this quote of Mark Twain, something like, all you need to succeed in life is ignorance and confidence. And all you need to succeed in life is ignorance and confidence. And I come back to the truth of that sentence all again and again and again, because if you know too much, quite often you would never try to do what you dream about. My wife thinks it's true as well, and it's certainly true for T3CON14. But it was great that we didn't know much more, and we just went head on things. And then 1 year later, in summer 2000, I finally thought I had finished it, at least to a point that I couldn't take anymore, so I decided to publish T3CON14 as GPL. And that started a whole new story, which is more or less public. So, and now I see I have a black slide here. Ah, okay. So what, I was getting a lot of fresh air. Ah, that's the point, this is why I put this. Publishing T3CON14 as GPL gave a lot of energy. It was not a loss, it was a gain, a huge gain. I was sitting there for myself, I had no one to share it with, but the moment I shared T3CON14, and people began to respond to sharing T3CON14, I was empowered to continue the development. And I think that's also what many of you developers feel. This is what you feel when you organize a social event in the community. You feel how it gives you energy to make other people happy. And that's why I continued, because it was hard all along. And I got my beard. Yep. Okay, and I think this is the truly black slide. No, it was not. It's black here. Okay, it's Snowboard Tour came along, and the Snowboard Tour was the first time we ever met in face to face, and we met Olivier also. And then later in the same year, I think we began to work more strategically on T3CON14. So we met up the group of people we could identify as active contributors. We created a logo. You see the layers. The in this logo, and was symbolic of content and pages and so on. We also tried to, Jan Henrik, did I see you? Gather people at the T3CON14 MetaDev meeting, the first kind of core meeting where we tried to identify a roadmap and goals we needed to reach, etc. Many of these things are on T3CON14.org, so you'll have a chance to read about the history there and see pictures and comments on all this. So I won't go into many more details about it. right now. Okay. So I already talked a little bit about why this all happened. And I have presented reasons for creating Type 3 at multiple occasions during time. I think this may be from the first conference in Karlsruhe. It could be. It's from an open office presentation. I could open that today. I tried to open the keynote presentation from the year after. Your keynote presentation is too old. Open source, we like open source. We have control over our document formats, but obviously not with commercial software, Apple. And it's even slow today. So I would present these as the reasons why I decided to publish Type 3. First of all, I had gone so far that I couldn't stop. I needed to finish. That's kind of a personal thing. Secondly, I felt, at least back in the time, that the commercial pressure resting on this product would have to make me compromise several times to push out a product that we could sell. And I'm not denying the logic in that. Companies need to make money, but somehow it was just more important for me to have integrity around the product or the code I was creating. Oh, luckily I have only one build on this previous one. I shouldn't have. Okay, so we go back here. So it needs help. Yeah. Where was I? Yeah, the organization. I didn't really like to lead people, okay? So I'm just overly consumed with myself and what I can do. I'm sorry, that's a part of the story. I had a really hard time to delegate work. Okay, and then there was this philosophy, as I told you about. I also had a reconnect with my Christian background, so I thought one way to be a servant, to live out my Christianity, has to be doing something with this product. I mean, it can't be a bad thing in that sense to share it with people. So that was a modern interpretation of loving your neighbor. Okay, so one of the problems I feel about at least the last thing as an argument is that it's maybe based on an idea that I got some kind of talent from God to do this, so I need to pay him back. Okay? Did I do Type 3 because I was obliged to do it? Did I feel I had to, that I now paid back in a way that I really didn't like to get something else? Could be an underlying idea or problem with that idea. So if you look at what I did the year after, we talked about open source motivations. And I identified at least this list, and I think it's kind of ordered how it would look for me personally. The personal itch is an idea I didn't come up with. That's an old one. But basically it is you as an open source programmer solve a problem that you have yourself. That is very strong. We also identified how we love to do open source because we are artists in some way. Then of course there's the ideology. Maybe it's the morally correct thing to do. Could be. There's an element of social life. I mean, you could go play football. You can also be in an open source community. That's also a factor why we might contribute to open source. Certainly, there's something about acknowledgement. We like somebody patting our shoulders. We like maybe to be famous. Maybe we want to live forever in the history books. And then finally, you will find that self-promotion could also be a reasonable reason to contribute, because you can actually make money from services when you get known in a community. Somehow, that's kind of different, and I think maybe there is a clash between these things. Is there? I mean, on the one hand, do we do it because we love our neighbors, but we also have this very personal problem that we want to solve. What about feeding the hungry, promoting ourselves? Is there a clash between these two schools of ideas? And I think for some years, maybe I have felt that I might have overselling this the moral reason for doing Type 3, because I felt that these other reasons I mean, I'm not saying they are bad, but they are just very real, in a sense. Okay, so I have this habit of once a year I spend a weekend in a monastery trying to just, in silence, by the way, so basically 48 hours, isolating yourself from all life outside, you're not talking to anyone, and that allows you to get in touch with your deeper ideas of who you are and what you're all here for. So I did this this year as well, and it's interesting what you find when you Google eternity. Huh? I actually own that Dio stick as well, and it doesn't last that long, you will know, down here in the front rows. I found that there had to be at least two different ways of, or two different aspects of finding the meaning of life. And the one would have to do with your earthly existence, the very fact that you're here right now in those 80 years you have to live. And the other one, which is ultimately satisfying, would be the eternal one. But I'm not going to talk about that. I think you have to explore it on your own. But if we look at all what has to do with our earthly life, I think there are many things that make sense to spend your time on. When people think about a meaningful life, don't you, many of you, come to think about Mother Teresa as a prime example of somebody leading a very meaningful life? I think many of us do. It's a life in service of others in a very clear way. It could also be a more modern interpretation. This is probably more realistic to many of us to be involved in some disaster relief. The cool thing about these things is that it's so apparent that you're making a difference. You don't even have to ask if you're making a difference for all of the world, because quite often it's a drop in the ocean, but at least you know that this particular person was helped. This is also how Mother Teresa talked about it. If you can't feed everybody, just feed one, and that's still meaningful. Maybe some of us find a way to make sense of our lives by entering politics or being activists about climate change or environmental issues. Some of us place a lot of trust in the family, in the next generation. And some of us may find that friends are the ultimate reason why we're here and how to make a contribution. It's definitely not work, is it? And it's definitely not coding. The counselor at this retreat center where I went, she invited me to do a little exercise. This is something you can all do every day. You can ask yourself, what today made me feel most alive? When did I receive the most love? When was I most happy? What am I grateful for? But another part you should also ask yourself is, what were the worst moments? When did I feel sad or burned out or least alive? Okay, so there are many variations of this question, but doing this exercise would bring you in touch with what is your deepest motivations, what is inside you that you didn't design yourself, but which is just there. And I did this exercise, and I was really thrilled to find that I'm not a nurse, I'm a programmer. And if you believe that what is inside of you that makes you happy is something that is at least morally objective, it's something that's good and that is maybe the meaning of your life to go for, that was really liberating. The idea is that this is not something you define or you create or you construct, but it's really something that you discover. You discover your passion and your purpose. That's the main point. Don't try to be somebody else, somebody you're not. Don't fake it. Figure out who you are. What drives you? Okay. So what drives me? I get a lot out of working. I don't like to say I'm working because it sounds like something we should do as little as possible to do all the other important things. So I wish there was a better word, something that identified what I mean by working, which is being, you know, spending time on things I'm passionate about. Okay, I admit that not everybody has a great job, but I'm looking at my life and it started out by following my dreams of type 3. I started that day to work on things that I loved, okay? And luckily it became my job, and I hope that you might see the same things. Maybe it's not your work, maybe it's what you do in your spare time when you work on type 3. Maybe this is when you feel alive. But the fact is that I get a lot of happiness out of working on projects like my work, on coding, on studying at university, on making videos at the university for teaching purposes. I love to play with electronics. I'm using my creativity when I do that. I'm learning new things. When we code, we construct things. And I tell you, compared to hardware, constructing things in software is just, there's so much flow to be gained in that process. So many other things in the world require much more time. But all these things are things that I love. And yes, of course, I do also love my family. Don't misunderstand me, okay? But I felt when I spent time to look inside myself, I realized that I was created by a God-given purpose, and that was to live out those talents that I had, those passions for creating technology, including type 3. And I'm not a nurse, but it's okay. Okay. Yeah. And then I couldn't resist putting up this one. I'm curious to see how many will follow through on this tomorrow night at the social event. Olivier, you can maybe organize it practically. Yeah. Okay. So if you look back at these motivations of open source, is it really that bad? And I think if you take a look at personal itch, you can find passion in that. That's passion for solving a problem. I think you can find definitely a lot of passion in artistic expression. What would it else be? Ideology and moral can also be a passionate endeavor, and certainly social life and socializing is. So I think in many of these motivations, you can find some kind of core that has a link to passion. And if you look at the type 3 mission statement, I think we have passion in every single word. And I even though we were sitting back in Denmark making this mission statement 10 years ago without knowing much about who we actually are or what drives us, we still put down these words in response to what just came up. We wanted to do something together. We like to innovate. It had to be excellent. It must be free so we can share, and we wanted to do it for somebody else to enable you guys and your customers and the world around us to communicate. So there was passion all along in these words. And even today I find that I'm surrounding myself with people who think the same. These are the two guys, Nils and Peter, who do the film scanner. They have a whole work life behind them in film and being passionate about film. Today they do this. They have had ups and downs, they've been rich, they've been poor, but they told me that every day they went to work, they did what they loved to do. And I found this quote on their pinboard at the office, which I find is ringing true to me as well. So really, I would like you to ask yourself, why are you here today? Apart from the obvious reasons that you may have a business and a daily life with type 3, but more structurally, are you involved in type 3 for some reason that relates to what you really love to do? So what you could do is to do this looking back at your day. Do this exercise to help you to realize what drives you. Is it coding? Social life? Is it organizing events? Are you involved in the local user group or the core team? What about the products that the Type of 3 community has? Or is it the Type of 3 Association? What, are you passionate for any of these things? But you also need to ask yourself if you are at the wrong place. Sometimes you have been there for a while and just stopped, and I am one of those guys who had to realize 7 years ago that now I had given what I could. It had to stop, and I've been really sad many, many times because it's so frustrating. I would have loved to be a leader of this community for as long as it takes because I know you have been suffering. But on the other hand, I responded to my core when I stopped working on Type of 3. I had given what I could. Maybe I'm giving you something today. I'm very happy if I do. But I responded truthfully to who I am, and I'm very proud of that. And I wish for you to experience the same joy, that you also identify what you like and what you don't like, and you try to shape your life based on that. I think that would lead to a happy life. So discover your purpose and go where it leads you. That would be my final words to you, or the opening words to this conference. So have a nice conference, guys. See you around.
Kasper, thank you very much for that inspiring presentation.
No, you wouldn't have said that if you know what I just did. Oh, thanks.
Okay, guys, can you just give it one more time for Mr. Kasper Skårhøj? Come on.
Thank you.